talking about NAFTA, an agreement that would come to be one of the few things made in America. In a twist that would make M. Night Shyamalan himself need to change his pants, the Trump administration on Monday announced what it called a breakthrough in the talks with Mexico to fix NAFTA. But it's not at all clear if Canada will support the outlines of the new trade deal. So I guess Trump took stock of our neighbors and thought, well, I'll probably have more of a chance of Mexico hearing me out. Which, jeez, what did you do to Trudeau? So before we either pop champagne or get under our desk like a 1950s student outsmarting a nuclear blast, let's do something unprecedented and read this agreement before clicking accept and moving on. As a quick warning for everyone who wants to continue to imagine Trump as the embodiment of evil, this agreement, well, it's pretty good. Now all we need is one with every other country. This agreement has been debated for months, and despite the way it was announced, we definitely weren't phoning it in.
President Trump, how are you? Good morning.
Thank you, Enrique, and congratulations. That's really a fantastic thing. We've all worked very hard. Well, your brilliant representatives are sitting right in front of me, and I thought we would congratulate each other before it got out. I know we'll have a formal news conference in the not-too-distant future.
Well, that's certainly one way to respond to how are you. So let's talk trade. One of the major things that this deal irons at is automobile manufacturing. This deal does something really smart. It imposes tariffs based on workers' wages. Basically, yeah, we'll give you free trade on automobile parts, but they must be made in factories that pay their workers higher wages. So at least the US government is advocating raising wages somewhere. Specifically, it requires that at least 40% of vehicles be made by workers who are paid at least $16 an hour. Now, this has never been done before, and it's an awesome idea. It accomplishes the same goal as tariffs, raising the prices on imports, but doesn't make us look like assholes. Hey, Trump's not trying to cut down on your trade, he's just a champion of the Mexican working man. How, in no meeting in the last 24 years with us talking about people abroad taking our jobs because they get paid less, did nobody suggest maybe if we make these countries pay people more, that might help? I won't know. And because Mexican wages are higher, that could potentially increase the number of jobs in American car plants, where workers are paid more than in Mexican factories. Of course, not everyone's happy.
When they talk about the workers, let's be clear, this helps some workers, maybe in the car industries, but it raises the prices for other workers, right? I mean, the definition of a good company, by definition, is almost one that's competitive in the market, not one that needs protection.
Turns out, when you have to pay people more, prices go up, and this is going to drive up the price of American cars across the board. So next time you're in Canada picking up your cheap prescription drugs, maybe check out their local dealerships. So besides making us pay Whole Foods prices for our cars, is this Hummer 3 fair trade? It does one other thing to the automobile industry. 75% of the value of a vehicle must be produced in the United States or Mexico, up from the NAFTA threshold of 62.5%. So what does that do? Well, you know how cars are a Frankenstein's monster of different parts? The engine was made in America, the sunroof was made in China, and the GPS, well, I don't know where that's from, but it's asking me to make a U-turn on a six-lane freeway, so I'm gonna guess not America. This part of the agreement says that 75% of the components that make up the cars have to be made in either the US or Mexico. So the next thing this deal changes is...
It's the last 10%, of course, that's the most difficult. And issues like making the agreement go away after 5 years, sunset after 5 years unless all three countries act affirmatively, creates a lot of uncertainty.
Ah, yes, the sunset period. Something Trump really wanted to put in. Some of you might already be hitting your caps locks and getting ready to tear me a new one in the comments. And yes, I realize that that news clip was taken from a time when we were negotiating NAFTA with Canada and Mexico. But, and this is a common theme on this show, nobody's talking about this, so I have to work with the footage I have. Trump's goal was to make it so that every few years the agreement would have to be renegotiated and agreed upon by all parties, or else it would die. Mexico and Canada were both against this because it's like expecting a bright future relationship from a guy who tells you on the first date he's afraid of commitment. Instead, in this agreement, a sunset period will be set 16 years out, and every 6 years, countries will vote on whether to extend that sunset period 6 years or not. Well, I'm glad we didn't make that unnecessarily complicated. Next, we come to the all-American U.S. export.
The new U.S. and Mexico trade agreement will help the U.S. maintain important market share that was being lost to other wheat and barley exporting countries.
I like that. So how are we going to do it? Well, first, free trade. Specifically, zero tariffs on agricultural exports between the U.S. and Mexico. Now, I know it feels like we walked in a big diplomatic circle to get back to, you know what, maybe we should keep doing free trade. But there are some differences. When people hear agricultural free trade with Mexico, they probably first think, oh no, Mexico's gonna start taking our agricultural jobs. And first, I think that ship has sailed. More importantly though, the worry is that with lower wages, the Mexican food producers will be able to provide a cheaper product and push our farmers out of business. Except for that one farmer who managed to convince people at Whole Foods to pay $6 for asparagus water. So how do you combat the incredibly cheap labor in Mexico? And no, you're not allowed to hire illegal immigrants. Instead, you put in enforceable labor provisions that require Mexico to adhere to International Labor Organization labor rights standards in an effort to drive Mexican wages higher. So again, this is pretty weird. We're fighting for workers' rights for our own gains. But those workers' rights are real. For example, as part of the United States-Mexico trade deal, Mexico has promised to pass laws that will guarantee workers the rights to form unions and negotiate their own labor contracts. Alright, what? Forget AMLO, is Trump the Bernie Sanders of Mexico? I swear, this is so weird, but like, in a good way. If we get socialist Canada in this negotiation, is Trump gonna demand a communist revolution on our northern border? The final piece to this new agreement with Mexico revolves around anti-dumping.
The way Chapter 19 works is that if there is dissatisfaction with an administrative decision on a matter of anti-dumping law or countervailing duty laws, it can be appealed.
The United States does not like Chapter 19 of NAFTA and got Mexico to agree to throw it out. This is a tricky point though, because Canada is fighting hard to keep it in. So what is it and who cares? Well, it's something that might have seemed a lot less relevant 2 years ago. Basically, it's a check against America putting up protectionist tariffs and dumping products on Canada and Mexico. If it weren't there, Canadians and Mexicans would have to fight these practices in US courts. And I see no conflict of interest there. This Chapter 19 Council isn't exactly dishing out harsh punishments either. If a panel with representatives from both countries agrees, it can require the return of those duties. That's about as brutal as catching someone burglarizing your house, escorting them out, and saying better luck next time. Then again, it's Canada who put in Chapter 19, so what did you expect? The threat is, if Chapter 19 were removed from NAFTA, then the Trump administration could more easily impose unwarranted anti-dumping and countervailing duties on all sorts of goods imported from Canada and Mexico for years and years, until the dispute is ultimately settled by a US court system. Don't worry though, the US would definitely never do something like that.
The White House is considering additional 25% tariffs on imported vehicles on top of the tariffs already in place on steel and aluminum. Sources say one way Canada could fight back is by putting even more tariffs on more American goods.
Sounds like a much better solution than going to a trade court. So that's everything we've agreed to with Mexico. This is not the final step, as it mostly covered cars and crops. Sounds like half of the country songs I've heard. But it is an interesting step in getting back to normal trade relations with our neighbors. The next step is to get Congress to approve this, wouldn't hold my breath on that one, and see if we can get Canada into the fold. Thank you, and that's all I have to say about that. Hello YouTube, I hope you enjoyed this video. If you want to support independent, nonpartisan comedy news, remember to subscribe by clicking on this floating logo to the right of my head. Or do it the old-fashioned way by clicking the subscribe button below. and click that bell so that freedom will continue to ring. Remember to give me a thumbs up, and as always, thank you for watching.